And joining me now to talk about skilled trades training is Eva Garza DeWalsh. She's the CEO with SARE Metro Detroit, and SARE stands for Service Employment Redevelopment. It's a nonprofit skilled trades education program providing training since 1971. Eva, it's good to see you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
A lot of people are talking about skilled trades. A lot of people are talking about the jobs that need to be filled that are out there right now. When you kind of go through the parlor here at the Grand Hotel and you're talking with business leaders, what are they telling you about the need for the workforce?
Well, definitely through the recent years, we've experienced a shortage in people that have the skilled trades that are in demand today. And, you know, this is because for so many years, for so many decades, the emphasis in, you know, schools and colleges was to prepare people for the university setting and not necessarily to go into technical positions or skilled trades. Now we're experiencing that shortage, and it's at a very difficult time when we're expanding everywhere. You know, businesses are trying to grow, and we have new development, especially in the city of Detroit. I can speak to a lot of things that are happening in the city, and what we're hearing is that businesses just cannot fill the jobs fast enough. They are, you know, working with us to see if we can prepare some of the individuals for apprenticeship programs, et cetera, to get them in that pipeline.
So, all right. So what are some of the jobs that we're actually talking about when we say skilled trades, broad umbrella?
Well, you know, we're looking at construction jobs. We're looking at electrical workers. We're looking at all kinds of technical positions as it relates to computers, technology. But mainly, and speaking from my experience in Detroit, is we're looking for construction workers. And within that, under that umbrella, there are so many different jobs. Pipe fitters, welders, you know, just all kinds of different trades and skills that are needed. You know, we have the arenas being built, the bridges being built in Southwest Detroit. We have new development, and now FCA is expanding, and that's like the news today.
And you have you know, the city council people saying that we need to make sure that Detroiters are going to be getting a lot of these jobs. So let's go ahead and talk about what programs are available for people to try to get into skilled trades, and maybe some of the barriers or obstacles in making sure that people understand what's out there for them. Mm-hmm. And then I think some of the wraparound services that I think of, Eva, to make sure that if someone, there's a single mom who has childcare while she's going to training, or is able to earn money while she's going to training, so she's not set back for 2 years.
Well, for instance, at SARE Metro, we actually do all of that. We have wraparound services for a lot of the programs that we offer. We're a provider under the Detroit Employment Solutions Corporation, which is the workforce arm of the city of Detroit. Mm-hmm. And actually, this I can use this project, the FCA expansion, as an example of how we're going to be involved. The city has Detroit at Work centers all over the located throughout the city, and individuals who are unemployed, underemployed, or who want, you know, to seek some type of job training can come to the Work Detroit at Work centers and register. In fact, when you're unemployed and you receive your, you know, layoff notice, these are the centers that you would go to in order to apply for unemployment and to get assistance in finding employment.
So the information is right there.
All
it's kind
the
of
information
in hand.
Is there. In fact, that's the agency that FCA is working with exclusively, primarily to recruit for these 5,000 jobs, almost 5,000 jobs that will be available with the expansion. And that's like within a year, less than a year. They're expecting those jobs to be available the end of this this year or the beginning of 2020. So we're now recruiting. In fact, we have, at through our Detroit Workforce Centers, which are located all over the city, we have the Samaritan Center on the east side. We have Northwest Activity Center in Northwest. We have Michigan Avenue, which is SARE, at in Southwest Detroit. And we have other satellite offices throughout the city that we're going to be conducting these recruitment activities. We'll provide job readiness training for individuals who come in. They're going to have to go through a preliminary assessment to make sure that they have some of the basic minimal skills that they'll need.
What are some of the obstacles? Because I think, number one, about returning citizens, people
yes.
who have come home from prison, from serving
right.
time, and that feel that maybe that they cannot get into some of these kind of jobs or trades?
Well, the good thing about some of the employers that we're working with, especially like FCA and some of the larger employers, is that they are giving preference to veterans and returning citizens. So we'll be able to identify them, find out what some of their needs are. In a lot of cases, for Detroiters, it's transportation.
You know,
jobs are plentiful right now, but people can't get to those jobs. And so the fact that we do have large companies like FCA and Flex and Gate and some others that have, you know, moved their operations to Detroit is wonderful, because now we have opportunities where people live. And so it's going to be, that's going to remove at least one barrier. Now, yes, we do have female. We're also recruiting, you know, in the skilled trades, trying to recruit female and underserved populations. And so, yes, there are unique barriers that they have as well, with children, small children at home. Retention is going to be very, very focused on. Once you get a person into a position, obviously you want them to stay there for the long term. So we've got to try to provide those supplemental programs and services. And we do partner with a lot of agencies throughout the city who offer those support services.
We talk a lot about what a high salary or a good living, really, people can make from being in skilled trades. But how long is the training process on average? And I know that we're talking about a variety of different positions here, but that also goes into how long it's going to take for you to be part of the, you know, the guild, the workforce.
Well, for instance, I'll use one of our programs that we're offering right now, which is Youth Build. We're funded by the Department of Labor to provide construction training to young people, young adults who are between 16 and 24. And so within that training, what we're providing is an overall comprehensive introductory training into the construction field. And so what that will do is prepare people to go into apprenticeship programs, which then can take, you know, 5 years, 4 or 5 years. But at the end of that training, you become a journeyman. And so the object or the goal is to get people into those training programs so that they can have jobs for the long term and not just an entry-level position.
Have you found that people are changing their perception of skilled trades? Because you did talk about how that push was the track. Everyone's got to go to college. But there's different opportunity. And then just changing the mindset of, this is availability, even through DPS, when kids can spend half their day, you know, at a tech school.
Yes, absolutely. Out of necessity, we have to change the mindset, because those jobs are plentiful, but they're also very high paying jobs, and they're for the long term. And this is what we want people to do. We want them to go into long term training, into a career path. And so skilled trades is one way that they can do that. And we have a lot of individuals also in Detroit that have been laid off from certain factories due to plant closings, and they're moving out of the city. And so we have some people that have some skills. They just maybe need to have technology skills, like computers. A lot of your new jobs in the skilled trades now require computer knowledge. So there's the challenge there, but we're meeting that challenge.
What would you say is probably your biggest challenge when you start work every week and say, all right, this is something that we now, this is the next hurdle that we've got to tackle here?
Funding, probably. I think that employers are now at the table more so than maybe in the past. You know, our funding comes from the federal government, Department of Labor, Department of Education. We get that type of funding as well, but foundations, we get grants. And so funding, is the fact that it's not consistent every year, is probably the biggest challenge. But I think everybody's starting to recognize how important it is. We're getting employers at the table. We have foundations that are now realizing, you know, you have to provide that job to families in order for them to be able to buy a house, to be able to put their children through, pay for their education, whatever it is they decide. And I hope they'll look at the skilled trades as well.
So for the next couple of days, what's a couple of your goals here at Mackinac?
Well, I definitely want to talk to foundation people. I want to talk to legislators to make sure that they continue to fight for people, all people, finding jobs and being able to sustain their families and to build our communities.
Okay, Eva Garza DeWalsh, it's good to see you from SARE Metro. And we will continue to watch the progress.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Appreciate it.
And we'll be right back. Stay with us.